Hello once again, everyone. There's one thing that I do a lot of work on around here on my workbench, and it's car stereos. This one here is a six-disc MP3 player from some sort of a Ford. I don't know exactly what car this came from, but somebody wanted me to fix it. And it's got issues with the CD changer, which is this whole like mechanism up here on top. And if we power it on, you might be able to hear the motor, or one of the motors, like whirring in there, and it's just like it's not really doing anything. Right there it tries to shift the discs around, but then it just stops and you hear this motor whirring again. And let me move the camera over here, might be able to see where it's coming from. I can get a pretty good view of it from right here, but if you look right there in that little spot, you see a little worm drive in there. And if I turn it on, it starts rotating, and I think that's the one that activates the rollers to load and eject discs. So that one's just going and going and going, and it can't do anything because apparently it's something stuck in there. This CD that you can see in there, it looks like it might be a CDR. It kind of goes back and forth, but nothing happens with it. So I'm going to be taking this apart and showing kind of how it works, and we're gonna remove all the CDs from it that are stuck in there and reset it all. I've done a few of these, so I'm kind of pretty okay at taking them apart and putting them back together properly, so I'm gonna show you how I do that. I've gone and removed the four screws that hold this assembly in place. There's two up here, and then there's two on the side here, and now this whole assembly just lifts up like that, and there's a ribbon cable right here that's held down with this clip, so I'm just gonna bolt down on that, and then it releases the ribbon. And that's the bottom side of the assembly here. You can see there's a ton of like little moving plates and everything. Got a few gears up here. The board is actually looks fairly simple. It looks like there's not much on this side here. Got a few switches, and now that I'm talking about these switches, what I've noticed happens a lot of the time with a lot of these changers is that the switches will become dirty and they won't make proper contact. So as the units are trying to operate, sometimes they'll come across one of these switches that are supposed to tell the rest of the controller circuitry that it's in a certain position so it can do something else. If those switches don't work right, it ends up jamming itself because it's trying to move a different part of the unit in a way that it's not supposed to, and then it ends up getting stuck, and that's how these jam up. And after it does that, there's really no way to get it to unjam without taking it apart and resetting it all. There's another motor down here on the bottom. I think these units have like three or four motors that take care of doing like all the loading and shifting around of the discs and everything. There's another motor back here. That's the one that takes care of the positioning around and everything, although I'm not 100% certain on that. It's been a while since I did one of these. And then the other little motor that was up here is the one that I think was the one that's supposed to run the loading roller. So we're gonna start off by removing the sides here. These are just for the mounts. So they have like a few little small screws, and those are just for these brackets that support the unit inside of the rest of the stereo. So there's only three screws on each side of those, so I'm just going to remove those. Okay, so the sides are now off. The next thing I need to do is remove this whole top plate up here. And these are held in place with a few little tiny screws. There's one here, one here, one here, this one here. And there's a few more on the side. There's that one, and then there's one right here, and then there's one right there. So I'm gonna remove those. That allows this whole top part here to come off, except that I also have to remove this tape right here, and I have to unclip this flat flex right here, so that just pulls out, and then this tape here once I get it undone. Actually, I think I have to do this whole little clear piece if I remember correctly. Just got to be careful not to tear these ribbons because they're so thin, and if you rip one of those, you're pretty much screwed. It's coming up.
And almost there. There it goes. That side. Okay. So that's off. So that'll allow this top piece to come off. Flip it back over. I believe that's all that holds it on there. Okay, so I've gone and removed all the screws that should be the ones that hold this top piece in place. So now this whole top part should just lift up. And at the moment, I'm not really worried about keeping track of where very many things go. We do have to remember is this right here has to, little notch right here fits in between that little play. It'll look, we'll get a better look at it once I start putting it back together so we can see what I'm talking about. But this should just start coming up now. These holes right here, they have this other little kind of a little bump that holds it in place, so that just kind of lifts up and then this comes out. There we go. Side over here on the back is being a little stubborn. But okay, see, that's because of this wire here. This is kind of interfering a little bit, but there it comes. So that's that top piece. This is what I was talking about. There's a notch here that's supposed to fit into this little part that kind of sticks out right there. It's a little hard to see, but once we put this back on, we got to make sure that this is in the same position as that so that that can fit like right over it. We want to get these discs out, and there's these little tabs right here that if you push them in, they'll release the disc. So got one out. This one here is actually, looks like it's bent downwards a little. For some reason, these are, I believe they're supposed to be like sitting there flat. Oh, actually, this one's not even in a spot. It's just kind of dangling there. So that could be part of the problem. And here's a, this one here is actually in one of its trays. So let's see if I can get it out through the top here. Just trying to be careful not to damage these. So here comes that one. There's another one down at the bottom here, and I'm just gonna push down on the tab and see if I can release it. Actually, that one's gonna be difficult to remove, so I'm not gonna bother right now. Because as you can see, it's wedged between this top plate, and then it's gonna be sitting on its own little tray. Okay, so the easiest way I've found to deal with this mechanism and to be able to manipulate some of the stuff in here is to remove this motor in the corner. And the way you do that is by removing these two screws down here. Once you remove those, this motor should basically just pop right out. I'm going ahead and removing these screws. And now this motor should just be able to be pulled right out. Like that. Uh-oh. You got to remove this wire from this little loop here, otherwise it's not going to release it. But so there's that. So this whole assembly here, this whole top assembly, you can just set off to the side. We don't really need to mess with anything on that. Everything that we need to work with is going to be in this bottom piece here. What we want to do now is we want to be able to freely move this mechanism up and down. And what these do, what these stepped cutouts here do, is that they move this whole like assembly up and down. And what that allows it to do is that it allows it to select which disc it's going to load, and it also positions the whole laser pickup assembly and spindle into the right position. Using these plastic, I don't even know what they're called, but these little plastic sort of plates here with these cutouts for the trays, it separates the discs to position them to where they need to be to split them apart. We want this to be able to move freely, like I said, so what we're going to do is we're going to remove a little snap ring that's inside of here in this gear. That gear is controlled by this motor here, which uses all this reduction to position this where it needs to be. It's fairly easy to get this out if you have a couple of really sharp pointy picks like this. I'm using two because I need to be able to get in there in that little slit on that snap ring and kind of pry it apart, what this is, it's kind of like a flat washer, and it snaps into a groove around this rod right here that holds the gear in position. So if I use this to kind of hold it and then use the other one to, it's really hard to do this behind the camera, so give me a minute here. Let's see. All right, it's coming up. So there it is, and I just got to be careful not to let it snap out of there and fly somewhere, because it's not going to be easy. It's not going to be able to easily replace this. So there's that, and we're going to set that aside. And now this gear will just slide out, no issues. So now that allows this piece here to move, and the front one and the back one work together by way of this whole bar here that moves both of them in unison. Let's see. So now we got that freed up. We want to find the right position for the trays here to be able to get this to move freely, because right now it seems like it's not in the right spot. It's a little bit tough to move. So I'm gonna rotate the gear inside there and get it to where all these, actually I should probably go back to that position where it was, around there. Moving these, I should be able to get them to all come together at some point. Feels like it's a little tough. So this thing like went really out of alignment here. So there we are. And now it gets to a point where this gear gets really easy to rotate, as you can see in there. It gets to like a spot where there's hardly any force needed at all to get it to move. But then if you go a little bit past that point, it'll get a little harder. So I'm gonna leave it there. And now this thing here should be able to move side to side fairly easily. So there it is. So now I can move this whole thing up and down. So now I know that it's in a pretty good position. What I want to do now is I want to get the rest of those discs out. So since they're way up at the top now here, I'll be able to push in on those little tabs right there on the side. You can see right there. So we got the bottom three that we need to push in to be able to get these discs out. So if I push this one here in, actually, you know what? Now that we've got this able to move freely, we can actually position it where we need to get each one of those discs out. So this one here, this top position, would allow it to play the very top disc, which I think is disc 6, but I'm not sure. It could be either way. It's like it's either going to be the top one is disc 6 or the bottom one's going to be disc 6, but either way. So we want to go to the third, that third from the top one. So we're going to go, let's see, this is top. We'll say this is 6. Actually, I think there's a way to tell now that I think about it, but no. Never mind, I don't see any markings for it. So we'll say this is 6, and this would be 5, this would be 4, and then 3, and then 2, and then 1. We want to get disc 3 free, so we're going to set it to the third position there. And now if I turn this gear, let's see if it's clockwise or counterclockwise. It's apparently going to be clockwise. Or not. Okay, so maybe I don't have it right here yet. Let's see. There it goes. So now it'll pull that disc out, and now I should be able to just lift it out. There it goes. Basically, I just had to do the work for me. So when I did that, it pushed that little tab there so that it releases that disc. So now I'm going to do the same for the other two that are still on the bottom there. I'm going to bring this back though by turning it clockwise till I get to that point where it's where it rotates freely for a little bit. Bring it down one and then rotate it clockwise again till it separates, and it should release that disc. And there, it released the disc. So now I should be able to just lift this up and bring it right out. And now we just got one more. So counterclockwise, it's at that free spot. Now last disc there, and we go clockwise again, and it released it. So that's it. Okay, now I'm gonna bring this back, and down here on the bottom that you can see that really large gear there, it says 2, which I'm not exactly sure what it means, because that's obviously not the second disc, and obviously I don't have a service manual for this, so I'm just kind of going by observations. I'm gonna go clockwise again, or not clockwise, I mean counterclockwise, and I'm gonna kind of help this along a little bit by putting a little force on this big gear here. I'm gonna get to a point where it says S, I believe. There, right there. And that's the spot where all these discs, or where the this lowering and raising mechanism is able to freely move up and down. And I think that's probably like what's supposed to be the like the reset position, I'm not sure. But now that we have everything freed up, I should be able to put it back together, and it should probably be fine now. Although, what I was talking about earlier, that usually what causes these issues is that these switches here become a little, the contacts get dirty, and they'll start acting up kind of funky, and where they're supposed to act, or where they're supposed to show that this plastic piece here is in a certain position, they won't make proper contact, and there will be too much resistance in the contacts, and this kind of throws it off. And so when the control circuitry thinks that it's in a certain position, it'll activate one of the other motors and end up jamming the thing because it's not where it should be. So things, you know, get misaligned, and then that's when this whole thing gets stuck, and then it's no good anymore. Now that we did that, so let me show you how I take care of those. Well, actually, one more thing I want to bring up. If for some reason these plates here on the side need to be completely removed, the way you do that is that by taking off these two screws right here that hold this little sort of support on there. When you remove those, it'll make it so that this piece here doesn't hit that stop. Obviously it removes that stop, so then you're able to just push this all the way over, and then these little pegs here will clear that those holes. I'm gonna have to remove this anyways because I want to get to these switches here, so I'm gonna go ahead and remove these two screws. And with these screws, one of them is longer than the other. This one here on the right is the shorter one. The one on the left is a longer one. And the reason why this one here on the right is short is because of this that large flat gear that runs along there. If this was longer, it would rub against it, and then, well, that's no good. So we remove this. And now I'm gonna remove this by using my one of these picks again. It's also got one of those flat locking washers, and I wish I would stop doing this and getting it out of focus. Okay, somewhere on there, right there. So I also don't want this to snap and fly somewhere, so I'm gonna use my nail here to kind of hold it down while I do this. All right, so there it is. So let's remove that and put it off to the side. We're not gonna lose it. And now this piece just lifts straight up. So that comes up. So there's the three switches, and I'm gonna show you guys what I'm talking about with this. All right, so I'm gonna be using my Agilent U1273A multimeter here. I'm gonna set it to ohms. I'm gonna turn on the continuity buzzer, turn up the brightness. I'm gonna set the range to 30 ohms right there. So that way it just stays within like a little range when I touch it. Okay, so I'm gonna touch the test leads to one of the switches here, and then I'm gonna push on its little tab, and we're gonna see how the switch doesn't keep a steady value, or it kind of jumps around. So I got those making contact there now, and as I push on this tab, watch the reading on the multimeter. I'm pushing it in now, and I'm just barely pushing it right now, so it's got a pretty low value, but as I continue pushing it, you can kind of see how it jumps around when it should be steady, but it's not. So this is what causes problems with these mechanisms, is these dirty switches don't provide the proper feedback to the control mechanism, and so it ends up activating another motor that it shouldn't when it thinks it should, and that basically ends up throwing everything out of alignment and screwing up its timing and everything. And as we can see, this is an issue with pretty much all three of these switches. So here's the second one. I'm going to push on the tab now. And see, I pushed, and then all of a sudden it stopped making contact for a second there. I'm pushing in it now. It makes contact. And yeah, see, it's really inconsistent. It's just all over the place. So it's going to be like that with this third switch over here too. It usually affects them all at the same time. They just, over time, they kind of get a little iffy, and then, yeah, see, it jumps all the way up to the 20s. It probably even goes beyond 30, and it's just, you know, I have it just limited to 30 right now, so that's what I'm getting. So the way I clean these is I use some of this deoxid stuff. This is it works really well, and I could use like one of those little clear straws that it comes with, that one, except that I don't like to spray switches like this directly I don't like spraying the stuff directly onto these switches when they're still in this mechanism, because I don't want to get any spray or whatever into the laser pickup. So what I end up doing in these cases is I'll use like a little lid from a water bottle or something. I'll just spray a little bit in there. So I'll just spray a little bit in there like that, and then I'll use the little clear straw, and I put it in there, and through capillary action, it actually ends up going up the tube there. It's probably going to be hard to see, but it rose like all the way up to like right there. I can see the line. So then what I do is I'll take this and I'll just let it drain into the switch like that, and I'll repeat that with all three of them. It's funny, the more you tilt the straw flatter, the more fluid you get inside of it. So got kind of a bit of shaky hands right now, but I'm gonna put some on there, put some on that one. I'm gonna use a little bit more. All right, so it's like that should be a decent amount. And then all I do now is I just work the switches a little bit. I just kind of cycle them just by continuously pushing them in and out like this. And that will usually clean them up pretty well. I do it for a while on each one just to get whatever crud is built up on them to loosen up. And after I do this, I'm going to apply a little bit more just so it kind of washes out any crap that it got in there. You can act on these particular ones, because they're triangle shaped, you can kind of go back and forth, and you'll push them in every single time you do that. And just want to make sure that they clean up pretty well. So I'm going to go and do a little bit more now. And this stuff is pretty safe to leave on the board. I haven't had any issues with it, so I'm not too worried about any extra like dripping down on the board here. It dries up after a while. All right, so now that I've got those switches, they should be cleaned up. Let's do another test and see what they look like now. we're expecting to see a large improvement over the readings we were getting last time. So I got them making contact here, and I'm going to slightly depress the little tab in, and okay, we're getting about 0.120 ohm. And as you can see, no matter where I push it, the resistance value stays the same until I completely release the tab. So that's what we want. We want it to be consistent and to keep a steady value no matter where or how far in the little tab is pushed. So that one's looking really good. Let's check the second one here. Oh, nice. And that's exactly what we want. We want it to be steady. Okay, and the third one. There's two more switches that we're going to do this to, and I just realized that one's actually on that top piece that I said we weren't going to mess with. There's one switch on there, and we're going to take care of that one too. But we want to make sure that all these here on the bottom are in good shape. So all of them are looking great. So we're gonna leave those alone now. And after we put everything together, it should be good to go. There shouldn't be anything else we need to do with this. But now I need to go ahead and put that plastic piece back on here, the one that actually activates these switches. And when you put this on, you can't just put it back on flat like this, because you're gonna just smash these switches in. You want to kind of put it in at an angle so that it pushes what it's supposed to, like that. And you got to get this little rod there to go inside of that. So see right here, it's supposed to be pushing that one in, and then this one's supposed to be in that little slot, and then this one's not being pushed by anything at all. So that one's back in. We'll put the snap ring back on there, and usually with these you can just kind of put them over the little rod there and then just push it over the top and it snaps right in. So that's good. I'm going to put this little support bar back on here. This serves a few purposes. It actually also kind of keeps these cables, these wires right here, strapped down, and it also serves as a stop for that piece as I was talking about earlier. Okay, so that's back on, and now we can continue with the rest here. Oh, this little plastic piece here came off, but that just snaps back in there. Let's go ahead and clean this other switch here. One right there, that it lets the controller know when it's hit its limit on that side. So that's just a little limit switch there. The way it knows which position it's in for which disc is by this little photo sensor right there. So as this moves along, it knows where it's at. So when it goes all the way to the end here and it knows that's the limit for that, then it knows that this would be one of the discs and then another one and then so on. So let's clean that one there. We just want to be thorough with this thing. We don't want to assume that anything's working properly, especially with these switches. Like I said, these are like the number one cause of issues in these mechanisms, or at least from my experience, they're what causes the majority of the misalignment issues and things like that. Okay, let's give it another go. So we should be getting a low value here. Then when I push this open, man, opens up, and then when I let it go, it should go back to a low value. So yeah, looks like we're good. I'd say we're good on that one, so we're gonna leave that alone. Alright, so I'm gonna go and put everything back together now. And then we'll put it back into the rest of the radio and we'll test it out. All right, so before I put this other top piece back on, I'm going to set this so that this lifting mechanism here is all the way to the left here, and it's hitting that limit switch. I'm gonna leave this at that S spot because that's where this thing is able to freely move up and down. And I'm sure there's probably some correct way to set this, but like I said, I don't have a service manual or anything, so I'm just going by observation here. And I need to lock this in place now, so I need to put that gear back on that goes in there like that, and I just need it to mesh with that other gear there on the side. So I'm just gonna wiggle a little bit. Okay, there it goes. And I need to put that little snap ring back on. that's in there. Okay, just using like a little flathead or something, I can get it to go back in its spot here. And there it is. Okay, so now this is not gonna come back out. Okay, now the only things that I have to put on here is this motor, and that goes in this direction here, and that just slides right back down there. And I just gotta put those screws back on the bottom. So that's fairly easy. Just gotta get the holes to line up there. There's a little dimple here that sticks out on the other side, and that just, let me take it back out here so you can see it. So as I was saying, that little dimple there meshes in with that hole right there, and then that's this one of the screw holes, and that's the other threaded screw hole. So once that's in there, you just got to get them to all line up, and you'll feel it once it kind of seats in position there. Okay, it just did. So just need to secure it in place with screws. All right, and that's good to go. Now this top piece here is a little tricky, but we're gonna try to get it right. Let's thread these wires through these little loops that they're supposed to go through. One of them is here, then it kind of, it'll feed off to the side right here and go through these little tabs that are sticking out. But as I was saying earlier in the video, what we want to do is we want to get these flat little plates here to mesh into, get that in there, to mesh into these little tab right there. So I'm just gonna need to move this up a bit there, get it to go into that. And there's one on the other side too. And this one actually just goes into this little peg right there. So that just needs to slide on over that. And let's get that in there. Oh, this thing popped out. So I need to bring this back over. Okay, I gotta pull it back out. This thing here popped out of its rail, as you can see. So I'm gonna move this one down. This moves to the left. Then I need it to fit into that part right there. Okay, and now this should just slide over to the right again, and there we go. Okay, so let's get these to slide back in there. And these wires that run along the top here for that motor, they have these little tabs that they just kind of ride over, and it just kind of helps keep them neat so they're not flopping all over the place. And I think this other side still needs to go in properly. Oh, it's mostly there. Okay, so that's in. This part here needs to go into that, so that fits over that. I think we got mostly everything here now. Okay, so now let's get that to fit into there. Once that's in, it just kind of fits in there. These cables are a bit of a pain, or these wires are a bit of a pain. You have to fiddle with them as you're putting this thing together. So they kind of fit on the outsides of these and then on the insides of those. And as you can see in the back here, it popped out. Okay, so now that's in. Now it popped out of here. It's a pain. Okay. Ugh, okay. It's not perfect, but it'll work. Okay. So we got everything in there, looks like. Looks like everything should be good. So I'm gonna put all these screws back on. I can't really test it without those on, because otherwise some of these things are gonna snap out. You gotta make sure that these little rails that are in here kind of come out the front so that they fit into these little slits, like that one right there too. So they just kind of get your nail in there and then they pop out like that. And these will drop into those little threaded pieces right there. Okay, so all the top screws are back on. There's a total of 8 of them. So there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8 back here. So that this whole assembly's back together now, except for this. I'm gonna get it to fit into its connector here. And then I'm just gonna push this down so it sticks back on there. Push that shut. Okay, so that should be it. Should be good to go. Let's see if we have any issues, but I don't think so. Only other thing I'm gonna do is because I've been touching that, there's all kinds of grease on it. So I'm gonna take a little alcohol pad and just clean it all off so it doesn't get any crap on the CDs or anything. And that'll just clean right off. And then just need to let it dry for a sec. Okay, so that's dry. Now I'm going to bring the rest of the radio over. Okay, so here's the rest of the radio. And I'm not gonna put the brackets on the sides back on yet. I'm just gonna kinda hold it here while we test it out. I don't wanna go through all that trouble to find out that I need to do something else. And I'm gonna figure out a way to hold it onto here. I think I can just rest it on this, on the front bezel there. And I'm gonna power it up and we should see it cycling through each one of its discs while it checks to see which ones are loaded and which ones aren't. And once that works, then I'll go ahead and see if we can load them and eject them again. So I'm turning power on now. There it goes. It checks one disc, checks the other disc, and then it just cycles through them all like it should, and it's working really well. So I think we're good now. Yep. Okay, I'm gonna try to load a disc here. I'm gonna hit the load button down here in the bottom. It's gonna ask me which slot. I'm gonna tell it slot 1. And it moves into position and it opens up the slot. So now it's on position 1. And I'm gonna take a disc and put it in. Nope. And there it goes. Perfect. So I'm gonna go ahead and put the rest of it together now, and then I'll load all discs and then eject them all and make sure that everything's working properly. It should eject this one as soon as I hit eject, so. Nice. All right. All right, so I got it mounted back in there. It's not completely screwed back in, but I'm gonna go ahead and load all these discs in again. And I just turned power on, and it's gonna cycle through and check all these discs, or check all the slots to make sure that there are or aren't any discs in there. So yeah, it turns out that the bottom one is the very bottom one is disc 1. So I'm gonna hit disc 2. I'm just gonna load all the discs in at once. Load 3. So good. So far, so good. Let's do disc 4. And here goes 5. and disc 6. You can see that little release mechanism that I was talking about in action right there. Alright, so looks like we're good. I'm going to call this one a success. So I just need to mount these screws back on and it'll be ready to go. So I hope you enjoyed that. If you like this kind of content, be sure to thumbs up. And be sure to subscribe if you haven't already. And thanks for watching, and I'll see you guys next time.